did tweet using the hashtag Visual Future. Mike and I are both on there as well. I'm Aimee with PR. For you, Mike.
You can figure it out.
Oh.
Yeah. You're Google PR. We'll do that. It's easier.
Come on in. Come on in. Don't grab a drink. We're going to talk a lot, but feel free to interrupt with questions and ask questions along the way. Don't worry about that.
So, by the way, can you hear us?
Yes.
Okay. We have one microphone, so we figured this is easier.
Yeah, rather than. Yeah.
We both have kids, so there should be no problem in you hearing us. We can project to the back. So I'll pick on Mom and I'll pretend he's my almost 14-year-old and project a little strongly if I need to. So just raise your hand. A couple rules. Feel free to leave if you get bored or if you need coffee. If you can figure out the hot water for tea, there's a bonus in it for you because none of us can figure it out yet. There's a set of stairs, so if you really get interested, you can walk up behind and peer over the side for a secret look at what's on here. So with that, why don't we dive in? What do you think?
Yeah.
Okay.
So does anybody know what this picture is?
Kirk Gibson,
1988. So a couple of you did. In 1988, a lot of different things happened. The Iran-Contra affair. Sonny Bono was mayor. Springs. Rick Astley, Never Gonna Give You Up, is my favorite fact from 1988. Things were different back then, though. We didn't have the same kinds of media flying around, photos on every phone. We didn't have phones in our pockets, and anyone who grew up before and after 1988 essentially grew up with social media in a different world than what we have today, or had back then.
But the, the interesting thing about, even back in 88, how do we take pictures? Film, right from Rochester. It's funny because Aimee and I will give this presentation nationally on occasion. We did it for a webinar, 50, 60 sites a couple of weeks ago. And so I was, oh, Rochester. And then there's that bit of sympathy, which we will take. But then we bring them back and say, you know what? Photography's always been a part of communication, visuals, right? And the great thing is, you know, we live here, we've experienced it. When's the last time one of you held a box like that in your hand? Anytime recently? No? Wow, when?
My daughter's taking the old-fashioned photography class.
The old-fashioned photography class. Now, what do you think is that's old-fashioned? 88, right? Old-fashioned. This is, I think I took this from Kodak when I worked there in before I left in 2007. Right? And that's old-fashioned. So that's tough.
It's a place that actually develops it.
Yeah, that's tough. I used, when I was at Kodak, I had a test. I'd go to retail stores and do the dust test, and it was how thick the dust kept getting on film boxes, and that would show the decline. So, because your daughter's taking this class here, I have no idea if it works, but you never know. If so, she can try.
I'm just going to take a moment to actually introduce ourselves. I'm going to introduce Mike. Come on in. You guys aren't late. Sorry if you were lost. That was part of our tour of the school. All attention. So Mike McDougall, he mentioned he worked at Kodak. Mike has a background in agency and corporate public relations. If you've heard of Buck and Lean that was here years ago, he was there. He was global VP for corporate communications at Bausch & Lomb, worldwide PR and digital marketing development for Eastman Kodak, and now is president of McDougall Communications. And in fact, we work with him at the Harley School for our existing website.
And Aimee, for those of you who don't know, Aimee has a long-standing career in education communications back in Tennessee with government work, in fact, Pennsylvania, and then moved to Rochester a number of years ago and worked for the U of R and then Harley as well. So, give you a little bit of perspective between the for-profit and non-profit worlds and what we're going to discuss tonight.
So we're kind of curious, just as we're starting out, who's in this room, because I think we have quite a mix. Are there folks here, raise your hand if you work in communications? Awesome. If you work in education? If you are a business owner? Great.
What else? I don't know, let's pass the bucket around.
Okay, I was supposed to get a bucket and I failed, but I didn't. business card that you'd like to drop in. We might add it to a mailing list, I'm not sure. But we're going to pass it around, and we'd like to later just kind of know who's in the room. We won't really bug you.
We might give you a prize, okay?
But we might also give you a prize.
That's it. Or two. Or
because
three.
Then, no, I know everyone's dying to know what's
it's under there.
I didn't bring mine.
You didn't bring yours. If you could find a friend with a pen, write your name on. Well, just, that's all we need.
I do, but then I'm
going to
pick one.
That's it. I promise not to spam you. I only spam you before in a net like this. You can't contact me, I'm sorry. Okay. Let's kind of move into the heart of things here.
Yeah. So it's really our hope that you're going to take away one thing. We're going to cover a lot more than you can remember tonight. It's a lot more than we can always remember. It takes two of us to present this thing. And we're really just hoping that there's one thing that we can have you walk away with that you'll be able to use in your job or use in your business or use in your hobby or just to be able to move along with. So what you're going forward with.
So let's start with, this isn't going to be a lot of tactics, right? There's a lot of tactical pieces to visual communications. A lot of what we're going to talk about tonight is strategic, making you think. But to start with, that's fun. We're going to profile some new technologies, some more recent apps that are really showcasing the power of visual communications.
Excuse me.
So if you start with this. Real simple, top pick fluff. All it does, and I say all it does, is give you a quick way to make an easy slideshow using your iPhone, photos you took, and audio already on your phone or your tablet. It seems simple, that's the premise, right? Aimee made that, what, 3 minutes?
Maybe.
Yesterday?
On the couch while talking with my mother.
And that's the goal. Visual communication doesn't have to be complex, right? You can make something very simple, very easy with a lot of technology that's out there today.
And it's free.
Also helps. Two, this is a technology, an app that we've seen, a platform. By the way, some of these are going to die. Some of these are going to be acquired. Some of them will survive. We don't make any predictions. But looking at potential, Beamit is meant to be a photo-centric messaging platform. So how many of you text messaging on a regular basis? Right, iMessage, etc. It's still copy-based, right? What comes up? It's a line for text. Beamit is all centered around the photo and using the photo as a visual means. It's also meant to send photos, to archive photos in a high-res format. Remember the days of O-Photo? I will say that from the Rochester days. So there was O-Photo, there was a Kodak gallery. We had Kodak acquired O-Photo and then broke it. But this is meant to be almost a resurrection of the O-Photo world. But in a messaging platform. Try it, it's interesting. I'm not sure if they're gonna survive or not, but it's been a good try.
How many of you would admit to using Tinder? Nobody ever does.
Emily does, right? Okay.
Use it now.
Wow. Hey, stop right swiping over there. Oh, sorry.
Well, there's a new app out there also called Like That Pets, which is essentially Tinder for pets. So it's trying to match you up with your favorite four-legged animal. And it's completely visually based. So you can say, oh my goodness, I think that's the most adorable dog up in the top corner, and it will try to find one within a distance you're willing to drive. It's just like a dating service, only it's doing dogs.
There's also the Amazon Fire smartphone. Talking about things that die quickly. Nobody has an Amazon Fire smartphone, do they? Okay, I'd be surprised if you did. It only launched last year. But it's unique. What Amazon did was build visual recognition into its phone. So it would recognize over 100,000 images automatically if you just held it up to all the images. And then try to bring them to a platform where you could buy the product. You can share the product. Good idea. Like a lot of good ideas, I think you'll see it come back around. Probably Apple will copy it, or one of our other friends in the technology industry. But more and more, our devices are going to be smart and visually, not just in terms of not just for what you put in, but in terms of what it sees around. Also, Instagram. Does anybody use Hyperlapse? Okay, got some nods over here. Hyperlapse. From Instagram is a time-lapse photography tool or a video tool that will take time-lapse photos, then compress them and play them back in a way that lets you see the world around you, maybe something that would transpire over 10 minutes, 20 minutes, an hour, into a very tight time frame. It's traditional time-lapse photography. Well, they've done those, put technology into it, take shaking out. Right, so it actually looks professional. It's giving professional tools to the amateur to use visuals in a new way. In fact, I'll show you a couple of examples here. I think I was sitting, it was O'Hare taxi on that one over here on your left. It's a sushi bar in California. It was fun, right? But that, I never knew that time from taxi to takeoff over there was. Andy, how long that took in real time? 15 minutes. I never timed my taxi out of O'Hare, and I never will again. In fact, I got bored. I'm like, oh my gosh, it's gonna stop. But if you think about the applications, how you compress time through a visual mechanism. That's also a theme you're gonna hear a lot about tonight is time. And then there's Rounds. Rounds is meant to be the next big visual app. There's another similar app like it in Japan that's taking off. It's meant to take face-to-face communications. Skype. Anybody use Skype for business or Link or any video chat technology and make it personal. So now you can connect with a friend. Let's say, Lisa, you had it on your phone. You and I can talk to each other in real time. Sure, you can do that today. We can also call a web page up and actually both correspond about the web page, draw the page, interact almost in a whiteboard technology. It's a lot of what you find in business communications tools being brought over to the consumer world. Again, early on, will it live? I question it. There's some limitations, but I like the concept. So then, what we want to get into is the foundation of visual storytelling, right? Because that's how you use visuals. They're used to tell a story, not a one-off. They're used to create a narrative. What is this on screen?
Bacon, egg, and cheese.
A heart attack, bacon, egg, and cheese, you're both right. So, Amish, which was a heart attack, it's okay. So, Amish from the American Heart Association, he's cleared all of our slides. That's why we're not serving these to that. We have cauliflower and broccoli. What's interesting is Nathan Mergel, who was at Microsoft and then left to become really a noted chef and almost student of food, had this quote up here. And I will not pretend I'm a creative director to read it to you. But essentially, what you want is you want your visuals to leave something to be desired. You want to make people work just a little bit to try to figure out what it is, because it's going to draw them into the story. You know, when that flashed up, it took you a second to figure it out, maybe a millisecond, but you still took it a little longer. It made you be kind of inquisitive about what that was. That's what you want to do with your visuals. Leave a little bit of mystery there. Now I'm hungry as well.
So along those lines, this is a photograph from one of the first graduating classes at the Harley School. We've been around since 1917, and this is the last graduating class. And it just shows you the power of photography, photos and how they can stand the test of time, how it doesn't have to be new. It doesn't always have to be something current or something that has happened just yesterday. But there is a power in photos that can pass the test of time, which brings us passing the test of time. Will your visual, the visual that you've chosen, the image that you're looking for, will it be compelling in 20 years, 30 years, even 5 years from now? What Mike was talking about, things that stick around, will it be able to do that in time?
We used to joke at Kodak. By the way, anybody here a former Kodak employee? Okay, right? So, now, you were Kodak, we had color photos on our business cards, right? Every Kodakian has a business, what's that?
Unless you printed your own.
Unless you printed your own, right? You had the color photo half, you know, half was your detail. Every now and then you get a recognition of somebody who refused to update their photo. It was still black and white, shot 78. You know, he had that 78 mustache going on. He was young. That photo did not stand the test of time. So truly though, think about the photos you use. And, you know, are they compelling? Not only a year from now, the photo you're putting on social media. Next week, what will that say? Will it still be relevant? Maybe it doesn't need to be, but keep that in the back of your mind. We won't get too much into the science. My friends here know I'm a little bit of a science nerd. But there is a system called the reticular activating system that governs what the human brain is interested in. As I say, this is the science of the art. This is why I have a bachelor's of science in communication as opposed to a BA. So I told my mom. At least she believed me. Took a PR. And what the RAS does is give you a few different mechanisms that triggers the brain to take note of things. So there's novelty, right? How many times have you seen a photo because it stops you in your tracks because it's, you know, it's something you haven't seen before? It's novelty. Contrast. Remember those late night TV ads that shows the guy who lost 400 pounds, the before and the after? And then there's the mouse type at the bottom, right? Which is also not typical. That's contrast. You stop and you watch. Emotion. People here today, is anybody on Facebook? That little platform, you know, that's taking over the world, right? How many puppies do you like today? Kittens, rainbows, right? Kittens, yeah, it's emotion. There's an emotional piece of it. Patterns as well. Patterns will make you stop and think, or a break in that pattern as well. Example, obviously. And then speed. Things are moving very quickly, fast. That'll make the trigger the brain to actually try to stop them and figure them out. So think about how you build those into the photo. You can even put a checklist together as you're looking at the visuals. And it's not just photos, it's motion video too, to say, does it hit one of those? If it doesn't hit one of those, maybe there's something better. But ask yourself that question. So let's give you 10 trends, okay? 10 big trends in visual communications. Before we do that, where's the bucket? The bucket of fun. Look at that. What do we have in here? We have post-it notes.
Oh, I'm
going to
get mine in.
Oh, okay.
We never got an interrupted.
We're one at back, okay? There we go. You never got passed over here?
No.
Oh, okay. Oh, you missed the row. Oh, this is like church. This is great. You can call it Catholic. Okay, I take fives, tens are good. Anybody else? Front row, okay, we will wait. We'll put it right here. I was in China for Easter Sunday, and we went to a church. So we go, and I was with my boss at the time. We're like halfway into the service. He's like, do you think it's a Catholic mass? I'm like, I don't know. Right? And then they passed the collection mass. We're like, oh, we're good. So it's my qualifier if I don't open the right place. So we have more coming in. You want to pick one out there, Aimee?
I do.
Just for fun and excitement?
Don't worry, we will not.
No. What do we got?
Lisa Barron.
Lisa Barron? Oh.
No, it's all good.
Let's give you something, Lisa, just for fun.
Okay.
How about a shirt?
Something
with
a neck.
A neck?
Besides a shirt.
We're putting one aside for it.
That's okay.
We are putting, so.
I'm teasing.
No, you're not teasing. See? You? Okay, look what we're doing. Lisa?
She's
look at that. So first, bigger is better. And I say that because if you look at this touch screen, this flat screen, this tablet, any idea how big that is? Inch-wise, right? 22 inches. Okay, imagine carrying around a 22-inch touch screen. Obviously, I think that's Panasonic. That's for graphic artists. Lisa, you're getting one tomorrow. If we play your card, right? So, but it tells you that the world around us is favoring the big image, the bold image, right? Flat screen TVs today, you know, you can't buy one. You can if you really try. You know, under 40 inches. You know, 70 inches is easy to buy. 60 inches, things are going bigger, and you need to optimize for that size.
One of the most basic things we can think of with this first trend is our websites. And here's an example of when we were going through doing some research for the Harley School website redesign. Bride Country Day had this great use of photos. We went online, we looked on my computer, I looked on Mike's computer, and the laptop, and we saw that it looked really great. And then we looked on a couple others that have large screens. And it wasn't responsive. page. I didn't know why it had such large margins. And then we even took it onto mobile to take a look there, and it became even smaller. Now, I've used this as an example, and very, very recently, Rye Country has implemented a new mobile site that is more responsive, although their homepage on their website is still, you know, it is not. Another example, though, as we're looking along Murray, another independent school, again, great use of photos, shows you what's going on, very active page at the school, stretches the entire page, and when we looked on other platforms, it maintained those large photos. So even as our devices continue to fluctuate in size, they all went really small, now they're going back big, we don't know where they will exactly land, and there are many choices. You can see that with a responsive page, they're able to fill the screen either way, so you get the maximum use out of that device.
Do you know what happened when does anybody have an iPhone 6? Mm-hmm. How about a Nexus or a Samsung? Large phablet, right? Get the term mm-hmm. phablet, right? Toyota 6 Plus. Does anybody have this giant? You do, okay. Julie does, right? It's massive, right? Do you know what the ramifications of the larger phones are? What other industry was affected by phones becoming larger? Any idea?
Fashion
and clothing. You saw that, right? As soon as the 6 came out?
I said I couldn't get a 6, it won't fit in my pocket. The next thing I knew, American Eagle is now redesigning their jeans line to have larger pockets on the female pants because you can't put it in there. Now, I don't think Julie's is going to fit in there no matter what, but but they're moving in that direction. It certainly has an impact.
So, a second big trend, authenticity. That's the coin of the realm, really. Communications in general these days. But the more we communicate visually, it's a very truthful platform. It's a platform that there's an expectation of what you see is what you get. Now, the journalism industry, you have a number of people that are decrying the use of Photoshop, right? Even if you touch up the clouds or a little contrast, or remove a blemish or a speck of dust, you've seen AP photographers fire, actually have career limiting moves because they've touched up their photos in a bit of a way. You have to do the same thing, or take that into account as you're using photos, as you're using visuals in your own communications. Keep them authentic.
The only time you don't have to do that is if you're selling genuine fake watches. How many of you are wearing fake watches tonight?
Fake watches.
I had to get one on this last travel just because I love the slide, and it totally cracks me up that we can have genuine fake watches.
You're allowed to bring home two. I learned from the U.S. Customs agent I spoke with, and he was serious, so I did bring home two. So there is a wonderful report that if you want a copy of it, I can send it along, but from the Arthur Page Society that I'm a member of, and it's around authenticity of the enterprise. And I did say, they said it's the coin of the realm, right? And Arthur Page has published quite a bit on the move towards authentic communications. The beautiful thing about communication from a visual sense is if you're doing it in a way that is truthful, the response of your audience is also going to be there. There's only so much you can fake in a photo. There's only so much you can fake in a video. Use it to show your serious. We don't have it in here, but when the CEO, I believe it wasn't Virgin, it was one of the British, actually it was British Airways. They had a strike by airline attendants, and the union hit Con out to say, you know what, nobody's flying to the Heathrow. What did he do? He brought his team into Heathrow and shot video of BA planes taking off, the people boarding. And they put that up online and said, look, they can say all they want, I'm showing you, we're flying right now. And that is effective, right? So it's not just words, it's bringing those visuals to life. So I'm gonna talk over this. Part of authenticity is also bringing in the visual experiences of your audiences, of your customers. Is anybody on a GoPro camera? Yeah, a couple heads. Anybody want on a GoPro camera? I looked at Emily. Emily's like begging for a GoPro. Buy one for the office, right? GoPro will take videos from their customers once a day and run them, and use them as a testament to the power of GoPro and what it does. You know, it's very much like Kodak, photo of the day. Just bringing it back on a different platform. That's just gorgeous.
Some are going to to travel all over, whether it's local travel or international. And one of the things they've done is on Instagram, they have had this great campaign. So first you can, they hashtag with Twitter and everything, win a GoPro, gave one out, they got them some publicity, got them some followers. And then they have people, all of their fans, focus on different themes and win contests where they're featured. And then they're featuring all of those beautiful photos, and they've made no investment in this travel on their own. It's completely sharing a fan-based, you know, user-oriented photos just from everyone across the world and getting a great group of followers from them. So we're going to talk a little next, number three, about consumption, how people consume media. The first thing that is very interesting is to talk about attention span, and I'm glad that you guys all still look engaged, because when I read my attention, read the data on attention span, I think, oh my gosh, no one's going to sit through this presentation. So in 2000, the average attention span was about 12 seconds. That's how long we could keep and hold it. In 2013, it dropped down to 8 seconds, and this is adults of all ages. And the sad, sad fact is that goldfish is right around 9. So we don't have people for very long. We know that. You know, we're all using social media. We're all engaged in conversations and working and busy throughout the day. And, you know, if you're at a red light too long, you just might check your phone and see if you got that text or an email, or, you know, it might lead to a lot of bad ideas and bad choices. But we are constantly moving. We're constantly multitasking. We're constantly thinking about 8 different things at once. So it's really no surprise that our attention span has led to jumping around quickly.
So how do you capitalize on it? If you're GE, you create a 6-second science fair. There's another platform, a visual platform called Vine, which just allows 6-second videos. And GE said, you know what? I thought we could teach a lot of science in 6 seconds. I'm going to show you a couple. These are all submitted from students and adults around the world to say, what can you show in 6 seconds? Solar through visions. Storylines are emerging. Okay, so trend number 4. Who likes a good story? Anybody? Favorite stories in the room, TV shows, books, movies. All right, give me one. What's your most favorite story of all time?
Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt.
Oh, The Unbreakable Kimmy Schmidt. See from the back, a Netflix series. You love Kimmy? See, we're gonna go with Kimmy then, all right? Okay.
If you haven't watched Kimmy Schmidt, you should.
The storylines are reemerging. How to use the power of photography to tell not just a snapshot in time, but to create an entire narrative. Now, the funny thing is, photography, graphics, images have always been used to tell stories. And in fact, in ways that I think we forget, infographics, right, are all around us. It used to be that little USA Today snapshot that was so amazing, you know, back in the late 80s, early 90s. This is an infographic from 1861. It's Napoleon's March on Moscow. Now, this is believed to be the first infographic in the world, but we have an older one, so I think Aimee gets credit for this. This is Florence Nightingale back in 1857, diagramming the causes of morality in the Army of the East. Fascinating, but you know what? It works. It's been with us. It's nothing new. In fact, a lot of our visual communications strategies we're going to share tonight are built on principles that have been with us over time. It's just applying them in a new form. A lot of it's visual today, a lot of it was analog, a lot of it's more in a time-compressed manner, but the concepts themselves take root in a lot of what we've done, you know, over the decades.
One of the great things about this, too, is take infographics and they can be shared, they can be borrowed. You don't have to create them all on your own. In fact, these are some examples that we use here at Harley. We're in the national organizations. We work with the Ocean Conservancy to do some of their, they pass out different sites, some information so that you can do cleanup. We participate here with Lake Ontario. And they provide on their website all of these different infographics that we are able to share on Facebook. We give them credit that we can use on our website to help get the word out about the impact that we're having. We don't have to create them all on our own. And there's a ton of them out there. So it seems overwhelming to start from scratch to put the information together. But you don't always have to do that. There's a lot of models. So this is just a different example. It's something I'm hoping that I can meet Michael Anderson, because we've used him for a while. But this is an example of a resume as an infographic. And what an interesting concept. Imagine this if you're hiring, coming across your desk, that you can learn things about his skills and where he's worked and all of that. But what I love is down here at the bottom, he has his daily intake and output of coffee, focus, communication. So you can learn that he's not really a morning person. He needs a lot of coffee. He doesn't wake up chatting. He doesn't really want to talk first thing in the morning. But his humor, around 2 in the afternoon, it is at its peak. And so it's just an interesting way to learn more about this potential candidate, Michael Anderson. More than just about his job experience.
Also, you learn that he wakes up at 8 a.m. So, interesting. Now, it's not that to be infographics that you have to be a designer to put together. You can also use data visualization. This is something that's actually just in this week's issue of Business Week, Bloomberg Business Week. It's taking a look at the four speeches announcing the candidacy of four presidential candidates, right? Who do we have? Ted Cruz, Rand Paul, Hillary, and Marco Rubio. Looking at the extent of their speeches and then color coding them for content to show you what matters most to them. Really interesting. The yellow is talking about their parents. So, you know, Ted started with his parents and he forgot about them. You know, Marco's been there a couple of times. Hillary didn't have time to talk about her parents at all. God is in there, America. The blue I is every time they use the word I, which I found interesting. And I'm not even speaking of my politics. Rand Paul used the word I 88 times. Small things that you may not notice until they're presented in a manner like this. I say it's relatively easy to do. We've actually done this for our clients. We had a round table of doctors for about an hour and a half in the UK a few months ago. We went through and just color-coded based on topic and content. And it suddenly became clear what they were passionate about, as opposed to just trying to read it again and again. There's a great New York Times article, too, on using data visualization for the sciences in the medical industry. If you want a copy of that, let me know. But a lot of work's going on here. And this is fun, too. So think about infographics not only in the static sense. How do you apply motion to infographics? How do you tell the story through a sense of motion and time? This is how long it would take to get to the moon. Seems like a long time, right? Lights are still on, I know this, right? Lights are okay, we'll keep the lights up. You can see? Okay. You're not seeing the great stars. Just pretend there's lots of stars on the screen, okay? So if you were traveling at 3 times the speed of light, or this is to Mars, I should say, to Mars, this gives you some sense that it takes a long, 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 long time to get there. You're going to shut the whole building down.
Well, I'm trying not to.
There's going to be a student that's having a bicycle downstairs next door tomorrow, power those bikes. Right? Yep, it's still going, right? Look at that. Right now, aren't you already getting bored? Right? This is bringing the sense of time. I think about time compression. It's going in the other direction in making you understand how long this will take. It's going to be about 60 seconds if you were traveling at 3 times the speed of light to reach Mars. It gives you a little bit of a glimpse of what it will be and just how much time is going to take to get Mars. So, now we can start to say some of the other topics. Those first four, strategically, foundationally, basic. Now we're going to start to poke and probe a little bit, make you a little uncomfortable. Which is more fun. The ephemeral. How many of you have heard of Snapchat? How many of you use Snapchat? How many of you are admitting to using Snapchat? Snapchat mainstream. You know, if I'd asked this question, I have asked this question a year, year and a half ago, people go, oh, I don't want to talk about that. My kids have it. Snapchat is certainly mainstream. Let me tell you why. The ephemeral, what comes and goes, is becoming how we live our lives, right? If I'd asked you 15 years ago, what'd you do today? Well, I did this, I saw this person, I did that. Did you document it all with your film camera and take a picture of everybody and wrote down every place you went and took selfies? No, I just lived life. This is taking life back in a digital realm with some documentation. So what you're seeing is Snapchat. Snapchat, you can send a photo or a video, it disappears in anywhere from 10 seconds or under. Unless you start to create some stories that will disappear in 24 hours. Kick. Has anybody heard of the Kick platform? Kick is huge among teens. My 11-year-old has Kick, which I kick him off of on a regular basis. Kick is a messaging platform where your messages can go in, go out, disappear. And apparently there's a lot of 3 a.m. chatter on Kick as well. Right, help my kids. Slingshot, up here, this little guy. Has anybody heard of that? Yeah, Lisa has. Who brought Slingshot out? You know who's behind it? It's Facebook's attempt at being Snapchat. It's failed miserably. They tried something different, but they're trying. So what it tells me is you're going to see other major platforms bring the ephemeral in, bring this here today, gone in the next second. Yik Yak. Have you ever heard about Yik Yak? Bullying cases. It's all anonymous posts. If you try to use Yik Yak right here, right now, could you? Blocked. So why do they block it?
School.
Your school. They block it in school, the geographic zones around schools.
Not at colleges.
Yeah, not at colleges. They just added photography on a beta basis a few weeks ago as well. So again, you can send a photo and it'll disappear. Wickr, W-I-C-K-R, is the latest. That's encrypted communication. I'm sure the NSA folks aren't very happy with us right now. Not with us, but Wickr. That's also, you can set up any of your messages to self-destruct in a matter of seconds to a day and a half. And then CryptoCat, which is the most bizarre name for a product I've seen in a long time. You have to set up a conversation name, but you go in and have a conversation, and then the whole conversation disappears. There's no record of it. It's like you met somebody in the parking lot, had a conversation, and never saw that person again. Why this is big is it's going to be commercialized. It's going to be used in your everyday communication. We have to become comfortable with it. I love this headline. This is from a couple of weeks ago. It's Hillary's Snapchat defense. Right? What did she do? She was using her own emails. She deleted her emails. She deleted the one she thought we didn't need to see. But I love the quote here from Michael Wolff, which is, big fortunes are now being built on the promise of separating what we want to say from what we want people to know we've said. And that is what's behind this ephemeral movement. Right? There's a lot, even in day-to-day conversations, I don't want my conversations being recorded for all time. I will use Snapchat, or I'll use a Wicker to send a quick message back and forth, and that's gone. If you look, anybody see the latest WikiLeaks treasure trove of so many emails that came out earlier this week? Okay, do you know there's a Rochester panel? Has anybody heard about that? Jeff Clark, new CEO of Kodak, his emails are in there to so many executives trying to get them to continue to buy film. So that's in there. Do you think he wants to see that come out? No, I bet he wished he used Snapchat. He wouldn't, but you know what? It's going to come. And I'm going to show you how. In 1 second, after this slide. So Snapchat, if you're a Snapchat user, there's also a monetization platform. It's a new service on Snapchat called Discover, which is you can get your news, you can get your information by just swiping again. And now all of these content providers are developing content for the Snapchat platform. So, Emily, when we watched the Vice channel to talk to a client in Buffalo, where did we watch it on?
On your phone.
On your phone. And you watched it on here, down in the corner. Vice. CNN, right? I showed this to one of the GMs from one of the local television stations, and he just shrugged. I mean, this is the way that video content is moving to platforms like this. So if you think Snapchat, if you think some of these fly-by-night platforms don't have a life, they absolutely do. By the way, I think it's, how many Snapchat users are there? 300, 400 million right now? I'm growing. I could be dead wrong on that, but it sounds good, so we're going to go with that. So here's what tells you also the ephemeral is here to stay. Facebook quietly put it into beta where you could have your messages disappear automatically over a period of time. If you are a Wicker user, remember I showed you that Wicker thing back there earlier? There's a WTF function, which doesn't mean what you think it means. It means like Wicker something function. That if you use that, it'll post to your Facebook account, only to your friends, or like, who are also your Wicker friends, your non-Wicker friends will see a picture of a kitten. It's bizarre. It's absolutely bizarre. But it's letting you share on your terms. And again, share in a way that'll go away. Tim Cook, how many of you have an Apple device? Okay. How many of you know that you can make your messages on your Apple device disappear? It's hidden deep in the operating system for iOS 8. Your audio messages, you can have them expire and won't come back to life. Your video messages, same thing. You can have them expire. Apple's playing with it. You're going to see it across the board. I think in the next couple of years, ephemeral messaging standard will be expected by a generation coming up through as opposed to being a nice to have. Now, here's how you can also tell what ephemeral technologies, what visual technologies are here to stay. There's one thing that connects all of these. The photography enlarger, the VHS tape, the Polaroid, the instant, or the Polaroid camera, the instant photo. Again, we're in Rochester, a lot of us had the Kodak one until they lost the lawsuit, patent suit, you all had to give it back. Even the digital camera. What fueled the growth of these visual platforms was one thing. Anybody want to guess what it was? It's a taboo subject, and I have to talk to it, because we're at school today, it reminds me. It's the adult industry. The adult industry fueled visual technology's advancement, especially the VHS instant photography. And we heard a lot in the past, even with Kik, with Snapchat, these are all used for kids. It's sexting, it's sending photos they shouldn't be sending. Yeah, it started that way, but look where it's moved. Now you have CNN on a platform that was used for sexting 6 months earlier. Actually, I look at this as a signal, usually for new technology or something that's about to take off. The adult industry, oddly enough, is an early adopter, they'll move fast. I know, it's bizarre, it is absolutely bizarre, but it's one of those things from a trend spotting perspective that you tend to look at and see what you can do.
Mike and I first talked about, we had a presentation back at a case conference in February of last year, and when he mentioned how many of you have Snapchat, one person out of 300 would admit to it. Everyone was like, oh my goodness, Snapchat. And people were saying, we'd say, all right, you've heard of it, what have you heard? And they're all saying, oh, all the teenagers. You know, and everybody put their hands over their part of it and they're talking to you. You know, Lisa, I know you talk to your dog about it. so it's completely different. And again, how can you make money off of this? Well, there's that whole Discover site, but there's also other organizations. You know, Business Week will send out to people previews of covers that are upcoming. If you're that into Business Week, you can't wait until next week. Juicy Couture, they'll give you behind-the-scenes tours if you follow them on Snapchat. 16 Candles is a yogurt company. You can get coupons, 10% off, special deals, just as you would as you used to sign up for email at your favorite department store or whatever it might be. And Taco Bell is a big one. And an early adopter, even last year when it was still used only with teenagers, Taco Bell was giving out not only just silly, funny pictures, but lots of different incentives to come in all of their new promotions and all the new menu items that they have and some of the different deals that you can get.
So, number six. Sharing is also shifting power. Used to be you had control of something. You had power when it was yours, when you held the cards. Now, the more you share, the more power you have. You notice on Facebook, if those of you use it, what pops up in your wall, what pops in your feed. You know, the more you share, the more people like what you share, the more power you have, the more influence you have. And photo sharing and video sharing, obviously, is part of that. So we're going to give you a little bit of background here on some trends we see. So one's around influence itself. Does anybody know what clout is? K-L-O-U-T? What's that?
Yeah, it's like your power on social media. It's a number.
It's a number. It's a score. You know what your clout score is?
I don't care.
You don't care. We can look it up right now.
No.
Does anybody know what your clout score is? Lisa, what's your clout score?
A couple weeks ago, it was like 110 or 12.
110 or 112.
Wow.
So, Lisa is highly influential, by the way.
But that's only because if you can pull them off the internet, it works now. Originally, you go and you just have to go on Twitter.
It is. It's very inclusive. It's meant to give you somewhat of a relative ranking of your influence. And what Lisa just said is important, right? Initially, it was only Facebook and Twitter. Now it is Instagram, right? The photos, your visual sharing matters. Now you say, okay, what does it matter except for personal pride, what my clout score is? One of the major airlines uses clout score as you call for customer service. If you're in their system, they will look at your clout score. So you don't give a higher clout score, you may be more apt to say something positive or negative, and you actually may get bumped above somebody else in the queue based on your clout score. It's that is what you see as influence. And that's clout, and you can game the system, but there's other ways of influence scoring as well. So don't discount the power of photos in your personal influence, or actually your brand's influence as well.
Here's just an example that we found. Fairmont School was setting up for the centennial campaign, and one of the things they did is they asked their alumni, parents, friends to post photos on their website and just have a quick caption. When we checked in, they just recently finished the campaign, but they had 100,000 photos and continuing to have more and more. And again, it's that idea of people sharing their own stories. It doesn't really cost them once they set up the infrastructure and have this in place. It doesn't really cost them anything other than someone to monitor it to make sure there's not something indecent being posted. But otherwise, especially within a close group like that, you're going to have a lot of opportunities that you can have others tell the story for you. So here's just some more statistics thinking about those emerging platforms and technologies and social media apps that are moving us forward. Pinterest has been growing, and we have just a little bit different information here. How many of you are on Pinterest? I struggled with it at first because I thought, I don't really want to do it myself, closet. What's on here, you know? And it's really, there's so much information. I thought, what purpose could Harley have for being on Pinterest? Is there any at all? And if you get into it, there's more than just how to make a million meals in your freezer, which I've done, and how to paint your kid's room and set it up and organize, and all of those kind of tips that they offer. There's a lot of other information, and in fact, we find at Harley with Pinterest, we're able to promote some of those in-classroom activities that could be done at home. It's a really good one for us, and we find a lot of our teachers just naturally are they're on Pinterest. So we follow them on their boards, and we want to share some math fun that they can do, or some snacks that they, healthy snacks they make for kids and things like that. But we were interested in how successful Pinterest is going to be, because it's hard to invest a lot of time in something if it's not going to stick around or be useful for your audience. We found that 64% of parents were on Facebook, but as you can see over here, Pinterest was growing while Facebook was dropping. But then, as Mike is going to the next slide, we looked again in the next quarter, and we started to change. So they've really been going back and forth, but it does look like it's in the game to stay. Facebook, there's been lots of talk about whether or not it's going to stick around, because how many people are on it. It's hard to say it would go away quickly. And Pinterest has gone up and down in growth. We've got some more information on there.
See, I might have lost attention. It was that 12-second thing, but I think there's more. I think there's platform basis. And this has some relation to visual, but it's also just interesting in general. You're seeing your social platforms segment themselves out based on the types of content being shared. So Facebook, heavier in health, news, and science. You look at Pinterest, beauty and fitness, food and drink. And then on the Twitter side, you know, things that move fast, especially sports, right? It's real time. Sorting ball. How many times, any Sabres fans in the room? Or other hockey fans, baseball fans? Hockey play-by-play on Twitter is really interesting to follow. I don't, but it appears in my feed now and then. There are fans who just follow games on Twitter now. Now, speaking of that, in real time, do you think the NHL loves that somebody's tweeting play-by-play? It probably violates all sorts of media usage policies. They're unable to really do anything about it. But give me a few slides from now. I'm going to show you what else they've tried to ban in the past 24 hours and have had no luck doing.
I just want to show a couple examples that are really great on Pinterest. This one is Middle Sister's Wine. Lisa, you have Middle Sister's Wine. This is what we gave away, and there might be another bottle over there somewhere. They have Pinterest boards, and instead of saying, hey, here's our new wine that's out, and you know, this is, if you're not familiar with it, it's, under $10. Instead of promoting their latest product or their latest kind, they have these boards where you could pick Smarty Pants sister, when you link into her, click on her, you can learn about her hairstyles, you can learn about her habits, you might find her Spotify playlist on there. All of the different personalities are broken out. And oh, by the way, you might like her wine, which is called this, which is this kind. And so it's just a much more creative, visual, interesting way bringing in all of those interests that you have to somebody. Yeah, I don't know who you have.
I have Forever Cool.
I have Mischief Man. I don't know what that means. So another example is at James Madison University. They have this, and they run their entire Pinterest site. It's done by students, which I think is kind of genius. Instead of offering traditional recipes or, you know, how to put a closet in your dorm room, they make it kind of interesting. We have this one board called Beyond Brown, and it's all different things that you can make, like on a hot pot or in a microwave in your dorm room. Different recipes, and they have other ones that are Beyond Purple or something like that, and it has where you can find in town purple, their school colors, purple shoes and purple hair attachments and all different kinds of things that would be related. Creative way to do it.
I think we should. Are there any middle sisters in the crowd here? Who's a middle sister? Wow, lots of middle sisters. Which middle sister can show me a photo first? Photo. Who's got a photo? It's a race. It's a race.
Sister or me?
If you're a middle sister, any photo.
Any
photo. You got a photo. It's a race. Who's quick? Hold it up. Oh! Okay, here's what we're going to do. Technically. So you get a bottle of middle sister Smarty Pants. Because you realized you didn't have to get up and you just showed it, okay? We'll give you a dry fit shirt in exchange for different sizes. Don't worry, there's more fun and excitement prizes. Aimee has cash. Time limits. Time limits and driving value. So this gets down to that time compression piece, right? What's this? Isn't it amazing that in a room this size, that many people know about an ice bucket challenge?
My 7-year-old was up here earlier and saw
was that, how long ago was that?
Summer.
Last summer, right? And it was the hot thing, right? Or cold thing, I should say. And then it quickly fell out of favor, but it had its time. So that's not timely today. I put an ice bucket challenge out on my Facebook page today, or sent you an email. You look at me like I was crazy. Maybe I'm like, wow, you're living in 2014? Apparently I was earlier in the week, so I dated two documents 2014, and somebody noticed and changed them in my office. But things have an expiration date. Even this, right? Now, I purposely stood over here so Aimee could be left shown. Nice, we're going to use the outfit. Left Shark was hot for all of what? A week? Week and a half? The time industry of value. You could buy a Left Shark t-shirt that night and have it shipped to your house the next day. Right? It was visual. That was Super Bowl. It was, for those of you who don't know, Left Shark was during the Katy Perry halftime performance. Left Shark really didn't keep up with choreography. Kind of his own thing. And it became a big meme. Yeah. So, poor old Left Shark, right?
Maybe YouTube it later.
That's it.
Today's YouTube's birthday.
Today's YouTube's birthday? How old are they?
10 years.
Really?
10 years ago today, the first YouTube video was posted. It was 18 seconds long, and it turned off the radio because I pulled it in the parking lot before I heard what it was. So, I'll have to look later.
At the zoo. But
what was it?
The founders at the zoo talking about the elephant on
it. Is that what it was? This is an example from a Facebook page about timeliness. We just see it all the time. As in this particular case, you posted something that had already happened. It was a poetry contest. It was a student who had received some honors, and anytime you put honors on there, they usually get a number of people who like them, student names or people know them. This particular one had 27 likes on it, which is a little bit low, but it was posted not immediately following the win for this student. It was posted about 2 weeks after the fact because we caught it. We didn't know exactly about it, and we caught it in a newspaper that came out a week after that. On the other end, when we post something that's timely, so we have this wonderful flower garden that was in our gallery after break, we posted this about 9 in the morning. And by the end of the day, we had 170,
sorry,
178 likes on the page. Now, you could argue that this was popular, but again, there aren't people in it even. It's a visual picture that people liked, and it was posted right away, letting people know, hey, we have this amazing spring garden. It didn't happen last week or the week before. But we see that constantly as we're posting things. When they're timely, people want to see them. When they're old, they've already heard it from somewhere else. Maybe it was posted on that friend's page, or maybe it was posted on the side of the newspaper. But if you're able to get it out ahead of everybody else, they're more interested in liking yours.
You have two options to your visual. Post them today, or you have to wait for a Thursday 5 years from now.
That's right. Throwback.
It's your only choice. So this is going to go back to the Ice Bucket Challenge. Just give you it's a little fun. This is going to show you the progression of the Ice Bucket Challenge over the time period it happened.
Can you feel it? Now it's coming back. Can you see it? If the bridge is gap, I can see it through the curtains of the waterfall.
So along the bottom, can't read. It's ALS Ice Bucket Challenge or ALS Ice Bucket Challenge. Ice Bucket Challenge.
Too fast and crushed it, but it's in the
and to see how much it peaked over the course of just about 2 to 3 weeks. Half that fell back off. That's the time of tools. Your window is much smaller than it was before. If you're saying, okay, let's work on a visual campaign, let's work on something that's going to have 6 months in terms of legs. Nowadays, you may say, well, hopefully we'll have 6 days. We may have 6 hours. Really going to reset what's expected. Highly effective. Did anybody have to come back around to them again? If they did it, they came back to you? I did. I was early. My son or a friend of mine challenged me. Actually, it was Julie that challenged me. Julie Rudd I work with, you were in the first week and a half of it, and it moved from there. In fact, I'm like, what is this thing? Right? Somebody cautioned me, they thought it was a scam. And my son convinced me to do it, and then the video he shot didn't work. So we had to do it again. Yeah, that was on purpose.
Big beer cat user.
right? He broadcasts their rehearsals. You go into the writer's room, and it gives you a perspective you don't see otherwise. How this is going to end up being used on a corporate and a nonprofit basis is still up in the air. It's early on. There's a lot in here right now that is people just playing, fooling around, trying to figure out the technology. It's a sandbox environment. That's part of the fun as well. Julie, are you actually getting any comments? Is anybody even following from the world out there?
I just stopped it, but yeah, we had 9 viewers.
9 viewers. I was at RIT the other night and just purposely started, I think I was meerkatting, for a conference on, it wasn't even a conference, it was a student group meeting on career strategies. And I was actually doing it just to show them. I had 29 followers. And actually people asking me questions to ask the presenter from around the world, right? They found the feed, they came in, they started making rude comments about the presenter, about the food that was on the table. I'm not kidding you, right? And I'm like, this is fun to watch. And then two or three of them actually got into it and said, hey, could you pass on along this question? How it's going to be using it, the jury's out, but a lot of opportunities. So, that also brings me to this point. Privacy is changing, the concept of privacy. If I can have you on camera at any time, what do we need to do in terms of privacy? What restrictions do we need to put in place? What cautions do we need to put in place? How do we act? How do we communicate ourselves, and how do we make sure we're doing so in an ethical manner? Let's say I went into Eastview Mall tonight and found these four teen girls sitting at a table, and went up and asked each of them to show me what was on their phone in terms of the last photos they took. Or better yet, pull their Snapchat accounts up and show me, you know, what had just come in. What do you think they'd do?
They call them all cops.
Either all, and both answers are right. We're at that stage right now where you have some groups who are like, that's pretty normal. I think they'd show me if I came and asked them virtually, but if I have a 40-something-year-old man come up and ask them to mall, get a mall cop, call the bar, and be there on the street right away. I'd be running out, you know, through the streets of there. But what you're seeing, though, is you're actually seeing some brands, some organizations, forget that and ask teens, ask others to say, hey, show me this, right? We're all sharing. We talked about sharing and shifting power, but also forgetting that they don't want to share it, right? Consumers don't want to share every photo, perhaps every bit. You still have to treat people as individuals.
We had an example of that recently, you might remember, Becoming Magazine, where one of our alums, over here in the corner, her mother sent this photo in which she lifted off her Facebook page. It was her profile picture for a week. And very cute. She's taken a selfie. And Brooklyn Bianchi is her name. And then the magazine was printed, and I got this phone call from her, this terrible voicemail, where she was very upset and wanted to know why we had lifted this picture from her Facebook page. And we're like, we don't know where it came from. Hold on, let's track it down. And we find out that it was her mom who sent it in. And I had a conversation with her, and she said, you know, that was a public photo. Yes, it was out there on Facebook, but it was mine to share and not yours. She's absolutely right. It's not, you know, so we asked her to talk to her mom, but. like, is it your mom's to share? But certainly now we've been a little more careful in asking moms, is it okay that the dads don't usually send them in, but the moms do. Is it okay that we share this picture with your daughter or something? No. Because just because it's out there doesn't mean that they want your school or a business or an organization or a media outlet to be promoting something or sharing.
So don't think you can just take something because you find it and share it. Remember that somebody took it, somebody owns it, and consider the privacy implications. So, now saying that, what if somebody shared something on your behalf just because they can? What if somebody shared information about you because you gave them permission, because you checked that accept box, as opposed to reading the 26 pages of essentially a fair warning. It's happening now. Does anybody know what this is up here? What's that?
Facial recognition.
It's something that probably has been used on almost every single person in this room. This is called deepfakes. This is Facebook's facial recognition technology. Notice when you post a picture to Facebook, it almost knows you now. It knows your friends. Sometimes it thinks my oldest is me, which is probably bad for him and good for me. It's like, Dad, I really don't look like you. Well, sorry, Kyle, but Facebook thinks you do, so therefore you do. You take up Mark Zuckerberg, just like you take up Brooklyn's mom. Right? Imagine, though, what's going to happen soon when a photo like this goes on Facebook or other platforms, and you can identify every single person in that photo. Imagine if you were in that crowd shot. Imagine if you were running a marathon. You told your boss that day that, my gosh, that was so sick. It was terrible. You're like, hey, isn't that, oh my gosh, it's Emily Jivietski. Gosh, she was sick. She's running a marathon in Pittsburgh.
Big liar.
Big liar, yeah, right? It's coming. It's coming. I think these are the privacy implications that Facebook, quite honestly, is going to be wrestling with, and others who want to deploy this type of facial recognition technology. It was funny, I sent Aimee a note the other night, I was scrolling Facebook, and I'm like, that looks familiar. And it was a conference she and I were at, representing the local PRSA chapter, I don't know, it was in San Francisco or Philadelphia, somewhere we've been. And it was back in my head. And I'm like, that's me, right? I can tell from my ear. But I'm like, okay, Facebook doesn't know the back of my head yet, but sooner or later, it will, and it will identify. So that is coming. And just think, be cognizant of what it's going to mean for your organizations. Think about the photos you post today. Think about the photos you posted 10 years ago or 5 years ago. Even on YouTube videos, where everybody has something to be identified retroactively. By the way, Facebook is doing this. They're going back to all of their photo libraries and retroactively tagging.
And they're not always asking permission.
No, they aren't asking permission.
Comes up and people are tagged.
You are tagged. It's not meant to scare you. Scare you a little bit.
Well, they still don't know. Remember,
any idea who you are. But think through permissions. Think about making sure people know that when you're posting, they're going to have their photo up. And it's not just posting in digital, it's other platforms as well. So the visual data, we talked about visualizations of data. It's also driving decision making. So what is this? Anybody know what this fun thing is? Google Glass, right? Did anybody ever wear it? You did. What was your experience with it?
It was, it took a little getting used to, but okay. it wasn't as annoying as I thought it would be.
Okay, how about the people you interacted with?
What do you mean,
What was their experience?
You had the glasses on?
You had the glasses on, right. And what was their experience talking to you?
I was in a lab as a scientist.
Oh, so they loved it.
They were showing me what they
okay. Were okay. I actually sat down with a gentleman. He was having a conversation with somebody else. I was at a conference in Atlanta. He turned to talk to me, and he had Google Glass on. And I went into, I'm something spokesperson mode. Because everything I said, it did appear to be possibly recorded. I didn't know. You know, there's no light that says, hey, you're on or you're off. It made me have a very different interaction with him. I think the change, though, is you're going to see this type of technology in a way that's not so apparent. That you're always going to be filmed. You're always going to be ready. Now, Google Glass has gone back into labs. It was a great Times article on why it broke, per se. Google was saying they rushed it out too quick. They shouldn't have given it to consumers. They shouldn't have made it widely available. It was truly a beta project. But only Google, in its infinite wisdom, can say Google Glass is graduated. Right? So that's what they said. It's graduated, which means we've taken it away, and we've pushed it into the lab, and it will come back out again for its debut at some future point. But there's other heads-up displays out there. Any idea what this is? Contact lens, right? Embedded electronics. Gary Orsborn, who's my former B&L colleagues, I work with Cooper Vision now, he's going to be here with his daughter sick tonight. I'm going to have Gary speak to this a little bit as an optometrist. But embedded electronics and contact lenses are very real. A lot of research ongoing. In fact, Google itself has unveiled a lens that has embedded electronics that can monitor your tear film to look at glucose levels for diabetics. Expects to be commercialized in the next year or two. Imagine, though, when your visual displays are embedded in your lens. It's not that far away. I think it's incredibly exciting. I also think it's going to cause a lot of problems from a privacy perspective, as we talked about earlier. But think about the opportunities. Think about how you're going to be able to experience this. We're going to give you some examples of what that constant heads up display can look like.
You can think about some of the things that are here now. How many of you use Amazon? Yeah, pretty popular. It has an app as well as you can go on their website. Amazon has hover technology that now free to shake your head. Now it knows what it is that you're looking for, so you've not only put in your search term, which might appear in your Facebook feed for forever after you've taken your, bought your, whatever you need, item, but then they also watch where you are on the page. So they can see where the, tell where your cursor is, where you linger, what you click on, but even just the things that you're viewing and considering. There's even some thoughts out there that Facebook is able, is currently tracking as you have your news feed coming in. People who you kind of stop and read theirs, maybe you don't like it, you don't engage or interact with their post, but you stop for a minute to read what it is, and then it'll serve you more of those either ads that are related to the topic or more information from that same trend. So some of that is here already where it's tracking what you're doing.
But it all comes back to the eye. In fact, not to scare you, but Facebook Messenger, seen as the devil, what it collects in terms of data. It collects so many data points. And not just on Messenger, but in general Facebook usage. I think it's phenomenal if you use it correctly. I don't think it was the marketers at Facebook that put it in. I think it was the scientists playing, throwing out among engineers. I know they probably code just to code. But they probably, in fact, people will say that Facebook and some other organizations probably know more about your habits than you do, which is striking. But as organizations communicating, right, it's our job to say, okay, what do they know? How can we tap into that? So, on the visual side, we're almost kind of wrapping up here, too. How do you track visuals online? There's a company in Boston, Cambridge, actually, a startup called Ditto. In Ditto, instead of searching the web through copy-based approaches, through characters, searches visually. Now, Google will do a little bit of that, right? You can search for Google images by dragging it. You can drag an image into the Google search box, and it will search for similar images. Try it. It's a lot of fun. Scary sometimes, but a lot of fun. Drag your own photo in, and you can find out that long-lost sister you never knew you had. You find out where your photo is in other places. But Ditto's trying to do the same thing. Ditto will then take your photos, take any sort of graphic, and try to provide some context around them as to intelligence. It'll actually create networks. Who's linking to your photo? Who's appearing alongside your photo? Say you're a brand, like the Boston Bruins. Did you know that more Jenny Light drinkers have Boston Bruin photos on their pages or nearby than Jenny Premium Ale? I don't think either of those are true, but those are the types of searches you can start to run. Even sentiment analysis, things you would typically do around copy, now you can do around photography or around images. So, we're going to play a little game here. Super Bowl. This last Super Bowl in Arizona. Did anybody go? That's okay. Okay. So, Ditto tracked the top 10 brands that got the most exposure during the Super Bowl solely from a visual perspective. They just isolated that to Twitter. So I need a volunteer. Come on up. Stephanie, come on up. Okay, you're going to play our Price is Right game. Any Bob Barker fans? Okay, what we're going to ask you to do, we need a little audience participation here, okay? Okay, we have the 10 brands
of
the Super Bowl, okay?
Wait.
Okay. We're going to give you a few seconds, okay? We're going to give you, let's say, 20 seconds. I want you to put in order from number 1 to number 10, the 10 top brands visually ranked during the Super Bowl. Okay, you ready? Okay, start biggest and best down there, then the least down here. And go. You got Skittles is number 1. Audience encouragement is being okay here.
Wait,
right? No, those are different. Oh, Bud Light versus Bud. What do you think? Is she making the right choices?
Help her out.
That's canon.
Doritos. Higher.
Doritos gonna go away.
Higher, I'm hearing.
Right now, I'm living my Monday morning sick at home as a kid, watching Bob Barker. This is great. We don't need to drink here. Okay, Doritos are moving up. So you got Skittles, Pepsi, Cheetos, Doritos, Bud Light, Cannon. Oh wait, take it again. Move it around. Okay. 5, 4, 3, She has one.
One.
Thank you.
think about how you can display what you've paid a lot for, and you can change it on the fly. Right? You buy real estate for a month, it could be a different message every hour, every day. And today's a little obtrusive. You've got to hold something up to it. Again, very shortly, you're not going to need to hold that device up.
Word lens,
or do that change languages?
Oh, yeah. Oh, right. Three people haven't seen it around to serve
it. There's a factory plan with the technology that you can do the same thing with print materials, right? You hand out, say, a brochure to somebody or an advertisement, and you put your phone over it, and it pops all sorts of options. It makes your material, it makes your communication. Much more rich. Is it gimmicky? Sure. But can it work? Absolutely. Actually, Esquire, Hearst has been playing with their own app called S2. They have one for it. That if you're a subscriber, same thing. You put your phone over the magazine and you can suddenly see rich content. It's videos. It's more in-depth stories. Could you go type it in? Could you scan a barcode? Sure. This just brings it to life.
We used to be so focused on school. Virtual tour, a slideshow tour of going around with the 360 tours. And now we think about, you know, how can we use this within schools to show prospective families what our school is like, whether it's here at the Harley School or colleges nationwide. But businesses can use this too. You can, you know, there's a lot of information out there for careers, recruitment, both in looking for the right vendor partnership opportunities, whether it's other not-for-profits as well. There's just a lot of applications in which virtual reality really
helps out what you've got. So we're gonna do one last video. This kind of wraps everything up we haven't talked about. This is something that's launching this week in the Shanghai Auto Show from Mini, owned by BMW. It's their vision in the very near future of what all of this together can mean from a communication standpoint. Okay? So you're gonna see how heads up displays interact with devices connected to the internet. You're going to see an interaction with a car that you wouldn't expect. It's a little futuristic, a little bit. I'm going to tell you I don't share his fashion sense, as you're going to see. But I don't think this is too far off. In fact, it's not too far off because this isn't just a bunch of guys in a room creating, you know, a what-if video. They're actively working with Qualcomm Corporation, the chip manufacturer, to bring this to life. So this is going to be about two and a half minutes. And I think you're actually, you're really one of the first to see this, had that much exposure yet.